Good evening and welcome to our nightly telecast of Just the News, where we give you information on everything that has taken place in the country today. Let's get started. Before we begin, of course, I want to give you a disclaimer. The news today is distressing, so if you are feeling anxious or feeling depressed, I would advise you not to watch the news today. Also, I would also request you to reach out to someone and have a conversation if you are feeling distressed right now. For the rest of you, let's get started. India today reported more than 400,000 or 4 lakh COVID cases in the last 24 hours as of numbers that were released by the government this morning. 3,523 deaths in the last 24 hours. The active cases in our country is now well over 32 lakh. This is the first time India, or for that matter, any other country in the world, has recorded more than 4 lakh cases in one day. Now, we run the risk of these turning into statistics or numbers, but every one of those 3,523 people who died in the last 24 hours belonged to someone. So just to give you perspective on what this number means, I want to remind you that when Mumbai was attacked by terrorists, the 26/11 attacks back in 2008, they killed 175 people. What we are seeing today is the equivalent of 20 of those attacks happening every single day, in which we're losing over 3,500 people in one day. Maharashtra reported 62,000 cases, making it the worst affected as it remains, followed by Karnataka, which is reporting 48,000 cases. The other states that are reporting large cases, Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. At least 16 COVID patients and 2 nurses were killed after a fire broke out in Gujarat's welfare hospital's ICU ward. The ICU ward had 27 patients in it when the fire broke out, but locals broke the glass windows and rescued the other patients. Gujarat Chief Minister Vijay Rupani has said a judicial probe will be initiated into the matter and the victims' families would be given ex gratia aid of 4 lakh rupees each. In Delhi, 12 COVID patients, including a senior doctor, died in Delhi's Batra Hospital. 8 of those deaths took place in just minutes after the hospital ran out of oxygen today. In Delhi, 12 COVID patients and a senior doctor died today in the Batra Hospital after the hospital ran out of oxygen. 8 of those deaths took place within minutes of the hospital running out of oxygen. According to the hospital, quoted by the Hindustan Times, it raised the alarm with all government-appointed officials at 7 a.m. this morning after not receiving its allocated oxygen. Despite this, the hospital did not receive its oxygen supply and completely ran out of oxygen at 15 minutes past noon this afternoon. Dr. Bankata of the hospital has been quoted to say, "We've been allocated less quantity of oxygen than needed, so we are constantly running around trying to get oxygen every day. We have also been linked to 2 suppliers, both of whom do not deliver oxygen on time. And the Delhi government tanker that was on SOS duty reached the hospital at 1:30, despite being informed at 7 in the morning," end quote. The hospital has currently received 1,000 litres of oxygen from the Delhi government's SOS tanker, which is going to last another 1.5 hours, according to the hospital. Quoted in the same Hindustan Times article, Dr. Sudhanshu Bankata, the executive director of the hospital, expressed fears that the death toll could increase because several people deteriorated in that period when there was no oxygen, and that will have a permanent impact on their recovery. By the time the oxygen supply had actually come in, 8 patients were dead and 4 other patients passed away later in the day. Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal said Delhi needs 976 tons of oxygen, but yesterday we only got 312 tons of oxygen. Meanwhile, NKS Super Speciality Hospital has told the High Court that they are in a dire situation as well. Delhi's Sant Pramanand Hospital has also complained about oxygen shortage today. They tweeted, "We are facing extreme shortage of oxygen. You are risking the lives of 80 patients," end quote. Meanwhile, the Delhi High Court on Saturday said hospitals should learn from their experience regarding oxygen scarcity during the pandemic and set up generating oxygen plants to generate oxygen themselves. The bench said oxygen plants are essential. It is irresponsible not to have them. The Delhi High Court directed the central government to ensure that Delhi receives 490 MT of oxygen allocated to the national capital by Saturday by whatever means. The court said that it may consider initiating contempt proceedings against the central government if 480 MT of oxygen is not supplied to Delhi. The division benches of Justices Vipin Sanghi and Rekha Pali, who have been hearing a clutch of cases in the matter, have told the centre that the water is gone above the head. Enough is enough. You will have to arrange everything now. End quote. The Delhi government earlier told the court that the situation pertaining to the supply of oxygen has worsened, as there's been no or minimum supply from the plants of Linde, Inox and A Liquid today. The Delhi government on Saturday also told the High Court that suppliers seem to be diverting medical oxygen to other states under pressure. Senior advocate Rahul Mehra, who's arguing for the Delhi government, told the court that the state should be getting 490 MTs of supply, but there's a shortfall of 800 MTs. Our tankers are not given priority. What's happening behind the scenes? My officers will have to give a breakdown, he said. In the meantime, the Health Ministry Joint Secretary Lav Agarwal has said that misplaced bravery of people who believe that corona is a scam and misplaced fear because of which people are hoarding oxygen and drugs should be blamed for the shortages in the country. He said that fear and panic are only being aggravated and are being complicated. They are complicating the agony on the ground. Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal has announced that the Delhi lockdown, which was due to end on Monday, will be extended by another week. Delhi is now recording 27,000 new cases every day, 375 deaths on last count, and it's reeling under the pressure of lack of oxygen beds and medicine. Moving on to vaccines, India launched its third phase of vaccines today for everyone between the ages of 18 and 44. Registrations were open on the COVID portal and the Arogya Setu app. Health Minister Harshvardhan said 2.45 crore people registered themselves on the portal. He also said the centre has provided more than 16.33 crore COVID vaccines doses to the state governments and the union territories for free. Several states, though, complained about the shortage of vaccines. They included Delhi, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Bengal, Kerala, Rajasthan, Jharkhand and Punjab. The Delhi government has confirmed that it received 4.5 lakh doses of the COVID vaccine and has started vaccinating people between 18 and 44 years of age. They will begin, I beg your pardon, on Monday. Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal mentioned walk-ins will not be allowed. Only people who have registered on the portals to take the vaccines will be allowed. There's no clarity right now from the government on how people who don't have access to the internet or are fundamentally illiterate will be able to register for the vaccine. We're still waiting for that clarification. United States Chief Medical Advisor Dr. Anthony Fauci has said that an immediate shutdown of across the country in India for the next few weeks may put an end to the cycle of transmission in India. According to the Indian Express, to which he gave an exclusive interview, Dr. Fauci said that it will provide a window for immediate long-range steps out of this very difficult and desperate situation. He said, and I quote, "I don't know if India has put together a crisis group that would meet and start getting things organized. I heard from some people in this that some people in the street are bringing their mothers and fathers and sisters and brothers searching for oxygen. They seem to think that really there's no organization at all." And end quote. That was a quote from Dr. Fauci. In the meantime, the Supreme Court has allowed the State Election Commission in Uttar Pradesh to hold the counting of votes for the rural polls tomorrow. This comes after a teacher's body had allegedly written a letter to the Uttar Pradesh government, and this is according to a report in the Hindustan Times. The letter said that 700 teachers and other employees of the education system had died after they were called on duty for the four-phased rural election polls. The court was assured by the poll commission that curfews will be imposed in areas near the counting centers and no victory rallies will be allowed in Uttar Pradesh after the results are out. The Supreme Court directed the officials to save CCTV footage of all counting centres. Serum Institute of India CEO Adar Poonawalla, in an interview to the Times UK, has said he's getting phone calls from the most powerful people in India demanding vaccines. He said chief ministers, business tycoons and others are demanding instant supply of vaccines from the Serum Institute of India. Referring to the phone calls, and I'm reading out of a Times of India article, Mr. Poonawalla apparently said, and I quote, "Threats are an understatement. The level of expectation and aggression is really unprecedented. It's overwhelming. Everyone feels that they should get the vaccine. They cannot understand why anyone else would get the vaccine before them. It is not foul language. It is the tone, the implication of what they may do if I don't comply." Now, Adar Poonawalla is also currently living in London. He apparently flew out to London before the UK closed its window of arrivals from India. There was also a report a couple of days ago that he has apparently rented a home in London at the cost of $69,000 per week, which is the highest or a record rent anyone is paying for a home in London. He says, and I quote in the same article, "I'm going to stay here for an extended time because I don't want to go back to that situation. Everything falls on my shoulders and I cannot do it alone. I don't want to be in a situation where you're trying to do your job just because you can't supply to the needs of XYZ. You don't really want to guess what they're going to do," end quote. He also said that part of his move to London is also linked with the plan that he's going to expand vaccine manufacturing to countries outside of India, which may also include the UK. There's going to be an announcement in the next few days, he said, about Britain being possibly one of the production bases outside of India. This, of course, is related to the fact that the government had said that all state governments and private entities and private hospitals will source their vaccines directly from the suppliers, Adar Poonawalla, Serum Institute of India being one of just two suppliers of vaccines in India. UNICEF has sent critical life-saving supplies, including 3,000 oxygen concentrators, diagnostic tests and other equipment to India to combat COVID. It is also said that it's continuing to support the Indian government in the acceleration of the national vaccine rollout to equitably reach all population groups. Of course, we know that there is a large amount of global aid coming to India right now. We don't know, of course, how this aid is going to be distributed and prioritized for various states across the country. The Supreme Court has said that High Court should avoid making unnecessary and off-the-cuff remarks during hearings as they may have serious ramifications. This comes after the Delhi and Madras High Courts have been very critical, making strong observations against the central government, state governments and various other authorities on the handling of the COVID crisis. The advice came during hearings on the COVID-related pleas when Solicitor General Tushar Mehta, the one who argues for the government of India, and Senior Advocate Ranjit Kumar, appearing for the central government and the Bihar government, said such remarks gave the impression as if the authorities were doing nothing. The lawyers also said that government officials, including those who are COVID-19 infected, are working tirelessly to deal with the pandemic situation. The bench said, and I quote, "Even when we are criticizing a judgment of a high court, we do not exactly say what is in our heart. We exercise a degree of restraint. We would only expect that as freedom has been given to the high courts to deal with these issues, certain off-the-cuff remarks, which are not necessary, be avoided," end quote. In other news, Telangana Health Minister Etala Rajendra has been removed from his post on Saturday following allegations of land grabbing. Chief Minister KCR will now take over the post. This comes after several Telugu channels reported on the 30th of April that farmers in the Medak district have accused Etala of forcibly occupying their land. The Chief Minister ordered a probe into the allegations, but Mr. Rajendra has denied the allegations and said the media reports are a pre-planned attack to malign his reputation. A look now at news coming in from the world of business. The Delhi High Court has ordered that all insurance policies cannot discriminate between physical illness and mental illness and must cover both. The order was passed by Justice Pratibha M. Singh. She said mental illnesses can also be debilitating and destructive. The recent pandemic also highlights this beyond any doubt. Circumstances leading to patients requiring isolation, healthy persons being subjected to lockdowns, work from home conditions, loss of employment, lack of confidence of long durations will lead to severe mental problems. Such mental conditions need to be dealt with immediately. Availability of insurance for mental disabilities does not exist and is not only important but is an essential need, she said. Looking now at news coming in from across the world, the US has banned travelers from India, which will come into effect from the 4th of May. Certain categories of students, academics, journalists and individuals have been exempted. Other countries that have imposed similar restrictions are Hong Kong, UK, Canada, UAE, New Zealand, Australia, Thailand and Italy, among others. Australia has decided that Australian citizens who violate the ban to return to the country and do so anyway could face a fine up to $60,000 or a 5-year jail sentence. Now, this has happened after apparently several Australian citizens violated the ban of flights between Australia and India and used Doha and other airports to connect their flights to fly via and go back to Australia. Of course, this decision has come under severe criticism from inside the country that has banned its own citizens from returning home. Walmart has decided to donate up to 20 oxygen-generating plants and 20 cryogenic containers to India for the storage and transportation of oxygen. It will also provide $2 million to NGOs to help them fight COVID. It will also donate 3,000 oxygen concentrators and 500 oxygen cylinders for delivering oxygen therapy to patients at home and in hospitals. In Afghanistan, a suicide bombing attack on a truck has killed 21 people and injured 91 others. The truck crashed into a guest house which housed high school students and pro-government militia members. No group has claimed responsibility for the attack so far. There's been no indication on why this particular guest house was targeted. This comes as the final withdrawal of US and NATO troops have started in phases from Afghanistan. In sports news, an attempt to tackle abuse and discrimination on social media, football clubs, players, athletes and a number of sporting bodies have begun a 4-day boycott of social media. The show of solidarity against online abuse hopes to encourage companies and social media platforms to take a stronger stance against racist and sexist abuse by users of players. Rugby, Formula One drivers and cricket unions will also join the protest. The Premier League has released a statement prior to this 4-day ban and silence, saying that it will not stop challenging companies until discriminatory online abuse is removed from our game and wider society. One piece of good news before we leave you for the weekend. A sick man has provided free food every day using his two-wheeler in the streets of Nagpur even during the lockdown. Jamshed Singh Kapoor has been running a mobile langar seva wherein he provides dal khichdi to hundreds of people every day. According to PTI, he said earlier only underprivileged and poor used to come to get food, but now small eateries have remained shut because of the pandemic. So people from all walks of life avail this service. We're going to leave you here, of course. Remember that the source articles of all of the information we gave you in this bulletin is in the description of our YouTube video. So if you want to read more about any of this, you can find the articles there. Remember to stay home and stay safe. We'll see you on Monday. Thanks for watching.